everyone. It's Christina Herrick, produce editor for the Packer and host of Tip of the Iceberg, and I'm here with another podcast episode. In this episode, James Nichols, the president and CEO of HotSpot Ag and a pistachio farmer, is going to join me and talk about water. Thanks so much for joining me, James.
Yeah, thank you for having me, Christina.
Yeah, and I know it's going to be more than just water. We're going to get into technology and kind of the intersection of all of that, but I think it's really interesting when I have someone on involved in the irrigation industry, because there's so much to it. Obviously, you live in California. There's a lot of conversations around water use in ag, especially in California. So, you know, talk a little bit about water use of fresh produce in the state. You know, why does it get such a bad rep? You know, is it true how much water is being used compared to like what it takes to produce a hamburger? Talk a little bit about some of like that, those misconceptions and kind of water use in the state.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'd like to first start out with that California is a very unique state.
Yes.
And the fact that there's a really large balance between environmental, urban, and agricultural use. So, what I'd like to point out from the agricultural sector is that California is really blessed with having a unique climate, Mediterranean climate, warm, dry summers, cool, wet winters. That's really optimal for growing crops in California. I think there's over 450 different types of crops grown in California. And, due to the climate, it's really productive for organic agriculture. So plants do better in lower humidity and large amount of organic produce comes, you know, from California due to the climate. It also has the, you know, largest water infrastructure projects in the world for delivering water to areas that's good for both conventional and organic production. And so, yeah, the press has done a very good job at labeling farmers as overusers. And I don't think that's a fair assessment. You know, for the first thing, water is scarce in California. And when things are scarce, things are more expensive. That's the same thing with water. So in my observation from farming and helping other growers, from an irrigation technology standpoint, I see more growers under irrigating than over irrigating. One is that it's just it's expensive to irrigate.
Yeah.
And so the other thing is there's fairly large negative consequences for over irrigation from a plant health and production standpoint.
Yeah.
I guess in summary, growers face negative economic consequences for using too much water, and for both an income and an expense standpoint. And so I think there's certainly room for improvement, but labeling farmers as overusers, I just don't think is correct. And they're putting water to beneficial use to put food on the tables for folks within the United States and throughout the world.
Yeah, and it's interesting what you talked about is that growers might tend to under irrigate as opposed to over irrigate, and it makes sense. I could see, being concerned about that, especially in years when there's water scarcity, and then we're not gonna probably get into the whole junior water rights and water rights, but I find that part fascinating too. I come from an area and I just don't think about those things. Where obviously being in the climate that you're in and just being in the environment that you're in, that those are all inherent parts of what farming in California is like. So that's just really interesting. Let's talk about water this year. I know that was it late winter, early spring? My year is blurring together, but what does that mean? Do people then all of a sudden kind of take their you know, do they kind of go back to the way things were? Or like, talk about years where there's, you know, when it's not a drought, what is that like in California? And like, what is water use like then? Are people still concerned about conserving?
Yeah, very good question. So we've been blessed with two very wet winters in California. And what has really been great to see is how growers are using the excess mountain runoff water to capture that and recharge that. So one of the big things that I've noticed is the increase in groundwater levels, you know, from just 2 years ago. It's been incredible to see the rise in groundwater levels. Just see the infrastructure projects that a lot of these water districts have and individual growers have put into place to be able to do that. So to answer your question, you know, from a water conservation standpoint, the growers are, under the new water regulations, growers are incentivized to use as much surface water as they can. And we've really seen that. It's been a blessing just to have these two wet winters.
Yeah. So I want to get into, obviously we want to talk about HotSpot Ag, but for a second I wanted to talk, because you talked about recharging, and I think I kind of understand what that means, but you know, for some of our listeners and viewers that maybe don't. So when you talk about recharging, what does that do? It's not like a battery. It's not like you plug it in and it. So what does recharging mean, and what does it do?
Okay. Let's just talk about the San Joaquin Valley in California. Yeah. What I mean by recharging is diverting water from snowmelt, you know, runoff, and putting that into either agricultural fields or basins that will push water into the groundwater. Think of a large field with berms, and the sole purpose is just putting water continuously, allowing that water to seep into the ground and get stored as groundwater.
That makes sense. Yeah, that's interesting. I just thought that would be kind of a good place to kind of talk about. When you talked about recharging, I thought, you know, I'm sure a lot of our listeners are well aware, but just in case there's anybody tuning in that's like, what do they do? I mean, it's not like it's not like electricity, it's not like battery, what does that mean? So anyway.
Well, the battery analogy, I think, is a very good one. So I may use that later on.
I guess, you know, if you're thinking about the basin, right? Yeah, I guess that would be, that's like the power source, right? And then the actual groundwater, that's the battery itself. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. I guess that does work. Here I was being a little goofy and it actually did turn out to make sense. So let's talk about HotSpot Ag and kind of the genesis of that. You know, as I introduced you, and it very briefly, like I mentioned that your family grows pistachios. So, you know, you have both the farmer hat, and then you've also got this HotSpot Ag, which is kind of its own thing. So talk about the genesis of it. Tell us what it is. Tell us what you do and tell us about just give us a little intro into HotSpot Ag.
All right. Yeah. So HotSpot Ag is an irrigation automation company. What we do is help growers modernize irrigation equipment so that they can control and view their irrigation equipment in real time. And so and currently work with several different types of crops throughout the state. And then also working with a fertilizer manufacturer, putting in fertilizer injection systems throughout the United States. So the genesis was, it started as a project at our farm. One of the challenges we had was knowing how much water we were applying per what our plan was. And so when I came back to the business, my dad was doing the irrigation budgeting and, you know, wanted some help to know how we were doing compared to the plan. So started off monitoring flow meters, devices that measure the amount of water going to each field. And so after a couple of years, got good at that, started looking at the control control aspects, and asked the family for approval to try out or try an automation project at one of our ranches. And after a couple of years of success, they suggested I start a business. And so yeah, we've been doing commercial installs since 2019, and yeah, currently have a wide variety of applications to help growers throughout the state and the United States.
Yeah. So when you talked about water plan, I think a lot of our listeners are going to be like either shouting at their computer or their car or wherever they're listening to this for me asking this question, but I wanted to back up and talk about water plan. So when you were saying you were working with your dad to try to make sure the irrigation was either, you know, on plan or where things were, what does that mean? Like, what are you doing? Is it that you have like an X amount of a certain amount of water that you're only allowed to apply in the year, and you're just trying to make sure that the trees get that? Or is it like seasonally based on like the growing condition, you know, whether or not you're in season or out of season, you want to only apply X amount of water for the trees? Like, tell me a little bit about like, what does a water plan, like, what does that mean? And like, what do you do with it for the year?
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, very, very good question. So what a water budget or a water plan is looking at is what the demand of the crop is.
Okay.
For the most part, that's fairly easy to forecast. And then the second part is looking at the supply, what you're able to do. And so that could be a limitation from labor, from actual infrastructure, from regulation. So it's basically putting a plan together that looks at what you want to do and what you can do, and then and then executing that throughout the year.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. And like I said, I think there'll be some listeners going, oh, why do you ask that question? But I do think for those people who maybe aren't as aware of all the different aspects of farming, I think that's a good thing to kind of talk about. And then, you know, we frame it in with HotSpot Ag and what kind of data and information you're able to provide kind of with that water plan. It kind of makes more sense. So speaking of data, let's talk about that. So talk a little bit about, like, what you said, you know, you're able to kind of understand what's being applied and when. And tell me a little bit more about the actual fine tuning of it. You know, is it something where a grower could put a program together and like set it and forget it, and the water just is applied when it's needs to? Or like, tell me a little bit more about like what precision irrigation entails and like what you're actually doing.
Yeah. So the definition I have for precision irrigation is applying the intended amount of water uniformly over an expected time frame.
And so what
this looks like in practice is gathering information to know what to do. And so that's looking at what stage the crop is in. Is it vulnerable to water stress? What the weather is like? Looking at what your farm is capable of achieving, and then executing that.
Yeah.
And so within within this, so yeah. So what we primarily focus on at HotSpot is giving growers the tools to execute their irrigation plans. So from my experience, growers have a very good idea of what their crop needs. What we were the problem we're trying to solve is helping growers be able to execute that. So there's there's a lot of different challenges that growers incur, just executing the irrigation plan. There's, to get a little bit into the weeds, pressure is a big issue that we, help growers address. So, just think about if you're irrigating your lawn at home and the water pressure's not right, your lawn's not going to get the, there's going to be some funny looking patches in your yard.
Yeah.
Kind of the same thing too. And there's several ways we can address pressure challenges and flow challenges in growers' orchards and alert them to know if there are issues and allow them to make changes in real time or automatically make adjustments within the software. And then secondly, in California, the energy rates are going out of control. PG&E has the rates have gone up. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but 30-40% over the last 5 years, which has been
wow.
Yeah, and so another thing that we help growers do is save energy costs. So one for let's just say one pump. One pump not running during the most expensive time of the day for the summer can save growers anywhere from $5,000 to $25,000 per pump.
Wow.
I guess getting back to your question, it's not necessarily a set and forget it type of system. There's input that's needed from the grower. But what we do is just help those growers, execute what they want to do.
Yeah. And you said this earlier, and it's a good point to bring up. It's not necessarily just the application and the consistency, but as you said, it's the uniformity too. So as I was thinking about that, I'm thinking about an orchard block and you have an irrigation line, and it might be like the farthest tree in that irrigation line. You want to make sure that tree is getting the same amount of water and anything else, if you're doing anything else through drip, or however you're spraying, you want to make sure that tree is getting the same amount of whatever you need versus one of the trees closer to the start of that irrigation line. And that's, I think, the other challenge too, right, is there might be some inconsistencies. And I mean, there's a lot of reasons, right, that something might go wrong with an irrigation line. It might be, moles or voles or something gets in and starts chewing on, there are things. So obviously being able to have that data and that system, you're able to get a better picture about what's actually going on in your orchard, which is, I think, what all growers want. They really, you know, they don't want to just go on feel. They want to know what's happening and what's actually happening currently, and then being able to react to that.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I guess one, since we're in, you know, pistachio harvest right now, yeah. I think one kind of neat story from last year was, you know, using the real time data, the pistachio harvesters start at 4:30 in the morning. They broke, part of an irrigation, valve vent. And, we were irrigating another block, but because that vent was broken, it started spitting out water where the pistachio harvesters were harvesting. And so the irrigator, looked on his tablet before going to work and noticed that there was an issue, and he was able to close that valve, and prevent the field from flooding. So, that was one recent example of it being able to use the data, in real time.
Yeah. Where if you're out scouting, I mean, yes, it sounds like your crew harvesting probably would have discovered it, but it would have maybe been a muddy mess, or, you know, if it wasn't during harvest, it might've taken a while before you actually saw that, you know, out scouting in a field. Mm-hmm. And yeah, as you alluded to, there's water savings, there's energy savings. It's all of that. So that's really interesting. And, you know, I know it happens, farming, right? Accidents happen. So it's nice to be able to get a read of that quickly and be able to react, as opposed to, you know, having to wait and learn. I feel like we've covered a lot of, like, I had questions I obviously sent you, and I feel like a lot of them we kind of covered, one question kind of answered another. So, let's maybe talk about the future with precision irrigation. Like, where do you see this going? Do you see this kind of system getting involved, like other elements of it getting rolled into this? Do you see AI being something in the future? Like, where do you see precision irrigation and kind of what you've developed? Where do you see it going? Where's it going in 5 years?
Well, so a couple of where I see this going in, you know, the next 5 years, is an ability for the system to generate an optimal schedule based upon a grower's constraints. So scheduling is one of the, bigger challenges that growers face.
Yeah. You know,
balancing the water supply, soil type, crop type, irrigation,
I would think maybe weather too, right? Like evapotranspiration, like all of that kind of goes together, right? It's like, well, that's in the recipe.
And so basically, right now we have a tool where the grower is able to, you know, input a schedule fairly easily, but sometimes it could take iterations depending on, you know, what the agronomist wants to do, what the field work's going to be. And so the, you know, intent with this is to input the total amount of water that you want for the week, or, you know, the given rotation, and the system automatically generate a schedule based upon the preferences of the grower. I think the You know, one of the things I mentioned earlier is a piece of what we do, and it ties into the irrigation automation, is the automated fertigation.
Yeah.
So what that is a system that's designed to inject liquid fertilizer at precise rates and volumes. So we currently in year three, developing fertigation skids, and the real interesting thing about that is the ability to injecting, we've seen growers be able to reduce the total amount of fertilizer they've had to put on, just because it's staying within the root zone of the crop. Yep. and not leaching out. So that's really one of the, I guess, yeah, if I can pick two things, those are the two things I'm excited about the future.
Yeah, well, like you said, that helps the grower out that much. And it's nice to hear that, you're able to kind of program in that secret sauce of what the water use is and what the water needs are of the plant, and understanding that changes, but then being able to schedule that out in a way that then kind of helps everything roll along. And you know, it's not one of those things that's forgotten, not that growers would forget. I know, you know, you've got trees, you've got plants you want to look after, but you know, being able to fine tune that. So again, the trees are getting what they need when they need it, which mm-hmm. is, I think, the everything, and the same with fertigation. They're getting what they need when they need it, and they're only getting it where they need it, which is the other part, right? As you were saying, you know, again, with irrigation, you know, you can blanket irrigate, or you can actually target it and make sure the trees actually uptake what they need. Yeah. So what else? Is there anything else I should have asked about, but I didn't?
Well, yeah, I can't think of anything else to share at the moment.
Well, great. I mean, I'd love to have you back on the podcast, maybe talk a little bit more about, some of what you're working on. I guess the one thing I didn't ask you about, you kind of talked about several crops, you know, are you just basically in like tree fruit crops, or are you getting into like vegetable, you know, what kind of crops is HotSpot working in right now?
So we work in row crops, okay. Citrus, nut trees, vines, currently working with different irrigation pivot systems. So
okay.
So yeah, we just recently started working in Santa Maria Valley with row crops.
Okay.
Helping primarily on the fertigation side.
But, yeah, I mean, I guess that makes sense. You know, if you were looking at lettuce or vegetables or anything like that, that would be kind of an entirely different it's probably doable, but it would be a totally different type of system where, you know, if you're working in trees and vines, everything that you kind of mentioned all seems like it's in relation, or maybe even the root system is a little similar. It's, you know, they're obviously permanent crops for the most part, other than row crops. So, you know, that'll be kind of related. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's been one of the exciting things. With deciduous crops or vines, trees. There's a fairly big root zone. And so, the fertigation projects that we're working with over in Santa Maria, it's been really neat to work with those growers, just because the root zone in, say, a strawberry crop is much smaller. And it's been fun to work with them to be able to put on very precise amounts just to keep it in the root zone.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes sense. Well, yeah, that's all the questions I had. I just want to thank you for joining me. And like I said, you know, I'd love to have you back on the podcast, maybe in a little bit, talk about, you know, what you've learned. I have a feeling, you know, just knowing how farming works, that, you know, there may be some things that you roll out in the future and more lessons that you've learned. So, you know, like I said, I'd love to have you back on at some point, talk more about it.
All right. Thank you very much, Christina.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just want to thank our listeners and viewers for tuning in. And don't forget, if you like what you hear, you can catch new episodes of Tip of the Iceberg on your favorite podcast platform like Google, Spotify, Apple, and more. And that's a wrap for this edition of Tip of the Iceberg, brought to you by Produce Market Guide, The Packer, and Farm Journal. Join us again soon for more industry insights. Bye.